As many people know, I've been very quiet for a while. I haven't said very much yet. And this is no accident. My silence has been not only deliberate, but it has also been very necessary. For those of you familiar with my billboards, you know that we used to have a lot of billboards scattered around Port Harcourt. But we slowly came to realize that heading close to an election, everybody will be interpreting the billboards and the messages on the billboards as more political than anything else. So for me, I felt that at this point in time, it wasn't a time for politics. It was more a time for introspection. It was more a time for us to start to ask ourselves deep questions. So many people have said to me, it looks like some people need help with their allegiance. Many people have said to me that they expect me to say a few words. And of course, one of the very interesting realities is that many people, for some reason, are still confused as to why, expect me to have an opinion at times like this. Well, that's fair enough. If people give value to what you say, then I think we must be respectful about how we speak. Many people don't realize that leaders having the responsibility for what they say means that you must be careful what you do say. At a time like this, when we need people to come together, the last thing we need is for people or politicians to start saying things that pull us apart. So I was quiet and very thoughtful. But in recent times, I've realized that being too quiet can also be misinterpreted. So I thought I'd come here today and say a few words, at least, even if it is briefly, just give you some kind of an insight into what I'm thinking on a variety of issues, on the issue of the state of the nation, on the issue of the state of the state, on the issue of governorship elections come 2015, the presidency. But what I'm going to do is say only a few brief words and leave the rest to you, gentlemen of the media. When we are looking at putting this together, we asked ourselves, what is the objective? What are we really trying to achieve here? Should we be formal? Should we be informal? What I wanted was a media chat, a media parley. Me sort of in the center circle with the pressmen around me, talking, discussing, exchanging notes. A bit like the way we used to do it in 2003, for some of you that can remember. And from 2003 leading up to 2007, there was a very active dialogue with the media in River State. Now, from 2007, I have to confess, and it's my fault, that dialogue went a bit quiet. And it went a bit quiet because post-2007, I wasn't contesting for anything. And I felt that I did not want to take the spotlight away from my Meji because for some reason, when I spoke, it traveled long distances. So I decided to stay a little quiet and leave the issue of the governorship of the state and the affairs of the state to those that mattered. Of course, from time to time I spoke out. When Amechi called all militants criminals, we disagreed publicly. When he bought a brand new plane, we disagreed publicly. And a couple of other issues we disagreed upon. But generally and broadly speaking, I kept fairly quiet. Now, leading up to 2015, the silence really has to come to an end. But I did not want to re-engage with press releases. I didn't want to re-engage with press statements. I wanted to re-engage with a press chat, an informal discussion. And I'm going to try and achieve that here today. I hope you will be, of course, patient with me, but also understanding. Why am I doing that? Because I know that going forward, I'm going to need the media, and I'm going to need to continue to develop my personal relationship with the media. And for me to achieve that, it's very important that I gain and regain the trust of the media. Because they have to understand that it's not just a politician standing here, it's Toyin Principle. And I will be talking to you not just regularly, but routinely. And it's very important that we understand the working relationship and the need for the media in what we're about to do. So priority number one for me was the need to reestablish my communication with the media. And that's why I wanted something informal as opposed to something formal. I wanted that relationship to be established. The other reason, or the other thing I wanted to achieve from this was, I felt very strongly that if you don't speak, people will speak for you. In other words, you can be misinterpreted, and people can make statements about you. And River State is one of those states where rumor and gossip, no offense to Rivers people, of course, but rumor and gossip travels very fast and very far. Sometimes people gather around newspapers, they gather around their radios, and whatever they hear is what they believe. And if they don't hear something to the contrary, what they hear or believe in the papers or in the radio is what they take as facts. That's what they take as gospel. So I felt that my silence, as much as it was deliberate and necessary, was also a bit of a hindrance if I continued to stay quiet. Now, I must confess, I haven't kept totally quiet. But by my usual media standards, the level of conversation has been significantly reduced. And that is set to change. So what this is about, really, is setting the stage for the beginning of that conversation. Now, before I go into the question and answer session, because I want to presume that many of you have questions to ask, I just want to say a few very short words. On the issue of Nigeria as a country, on the issue of the National Conference as a discussion, on the issue of the missing girls, the hashtag Bring Back Our Girls, and all the publicity that I think that's generated, both positive and negative, I leave that to people to decide. But I think that ultimately it's positive, because whatever the negative impacts are in the short term, in the long term, it means that the light has been shone not only on the country, but on social media and the power of Nigerians to have a voice. The only problem I have, and I've said it publicly, is that at times like this, most countries pull together to find their way out of the problem. But I've seen a recurring decimal, which I think is highly unnecessary and not very healthy, where at times like this, we are pulling ourselves apart. Now, no matter what your personal opinions on this matter are, I doubt that any of you would disagree that what is most important and paramount is getting these girls back. That has to be what is foremost on everybody's mind. So at a time like this, painting the picture of a government that is incompetent, in spite of your opinions, does not help the issue. I describe it as demonizing the government. I think that the government did not handle the matter well. I would have rather they handled it quicker. I would rather they have handled it faster, but they did not. So rather than turn my aggression or my anger towards the government, I rather turn it towards Boko Haram. I rather turn it towards people who feel that human life means nothing. So what I want us to do now is to reflect on that. At a time like this, I've seen the IRA when they're doing their bombings in England. I've seen other terrorist attacks. At times like this, people should subconsciously ask themselves, who is the real enemy here? That's what I have to say about that. Except, of course, that when we're looking at terrorism, we have to understand that there is an objective that they want to achieve. There is an objective that they want to achieve. And what is that objective? Separation of the country, imposition of Sharia law in certain parts of it. We should ask ourselves, if by our actions we are helping their cause, or if by our actions we are stopping their cause, and if by their actions we are not looking at one very important item, which is they want Jonathan out. They want him out. And so I want him in. It's as simple as that. They want him out. I want him in. What do you want? Because in Egypt, they looked for the removal of Mubarak, but they didn't think ahead. They didn't ask themselves what would replace him. And they made a mistake. They are still trying to correct it. In Libya, they wanted Gaddafi out. Again, they didn't think ahead. And as I speak to you today, it's warlords and militants that are controlling pretty much most of Libya. Many Nigerians complain, but they don't think about the solution. What is the solution? The solution has to be that if you want Jonathan out, you have to have in mind what you want to use to replace him. There's no vacuum in government. So I want him in. Boko Haram wants him out. What do you want? If you want him out, what do you want to replace him? Nigerians need to think about that. Now, on the issue of River State, many people know my position. In 2011, I was one of the people that came and said, Jonathan is not ready to be president. And I said he wasn't ready to be president because he didn't line up, to my satisfaction, issues which I felt would be positive for the Niger Delta, and of course Nigeria at large. I wasn't convinced. I remember that I was one of the members of the Niger Delta Technical Committee. And when we came out of that committee, we produced a report. At the time, the president was then the vice president. And that report was stuffed in a dustbin somewhere in the villa. And I asked whether, as president, he would produce the white paper on the report. And I was met with silence. I wasn't happy with him. I wasn't happy with the government. And I took an alternative position, I took an alternative view. Now, rightly or wrongly, Nigerians came out in their numbers and voted for him. And I described him as the first truly democratically elected president of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. See, in democracy, which is what we are celebrating today, we must recognize when we are right and when others are wrong, and of course, vice versa. So, irrespective of my opinion, Nigerians came out in mass and voted for him. As president of the country, after about 6 months or so, he removed the subsidy on petroleum products, and Nigerians raised their arms up in despair, and people were calling for his ouster. Now, we've got to be a little circumspect on this. If you have voted somebody into power, and he has 4 years to deliver on that mandate, give him his 4 years, and at the end of those 4 years, if you don't like him, you have an opportunity of finding an alternative. Now, my brother Amechi said no, we're voting for Jonathan. And he voted for Jonathan, and the whole of River State voted for Jonathan. When that position was taken, I jumped on a plane and went to Dubai, where Atiku was grumbling about the outcome of the primaries. I remember saying to Atiku that, you've lost. The only thing to do now is to support the president. He's the president of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. Congratulate him and support him. Let's move forward. Atiku eventually did that. And I don't want to go into too much detail, but in summary, Atiku agreed to help the president. So here we are, helping the president, because at the end of the day, his own failure is the failure of Nigeria. If you are celebrating his failure, you are celebrating the failure of Nigeria. All of a sudden, the conflict between Amechi and the president. Now, for those of us that know the details of it, many people say, oh, it was governor's forum. Many people say it was this, it was that. It wasn't. The problem between Amechi and the president started before 2011. We know, because we have been involved in it. But I came on a radio program and I said that that problem could have been avoided. I'm not saying that both sides are not blameless. Both sides have faults in it. But ultimately, that problem could have been avoided. Now we see our state today, a shadow of its former self. We see a distracted government. We see a federal government that sees the state government as an enemy. And while the people in the executive can survive these, let me call them gaps or interruptions in service, the people of the state are suffering. All for what end? So my position on this was that the fight could have been avoided. But even if we're looking at where to point the finger, I said that pointing the finger is not the issue. The finger of blame can be pointed in any direction. But what I did say, and I repeat it here, just in case there's any ambiguity, is that if I was the governor of the state, this problem would never have happened. Now, I make this statement with all sense of responsibility because I know the details of what happened and transpired between them. So for me, the priority, first priority, is the people of the state. Personal ego, personal pride, personal demands are secondary. The people of the state come first. And that is why when there was a call by people to move from PDP to APC, I rejected that thing. I rejected that call. Because I knew the grounds, and I knew that the grounds were not solid, the grounds were not strong, and I had no reason to go. And I said to Amit, because at the time of 2007, when we decided to work together, Tinubu was one of the people who was consulted before that discussion took place. So I introduced Tinubu to Amit. I said to him, I said, I know that system so well, and I'm not going back to it. So, on the issue of the state of the state, unfortunately, politics has come into the way of governance. I would have rather it be avoided, but for whatever it's worth, it hasn't. But in the position that we find ourselves, we have to also reflect on the character and the attitude of our leaders. And we must be able to tell them the truth. Now, I know that there are some people here who are not from the media. For instance, I got some students from the various higher institutions of the universities in River State, and they're here as well. But for those of you in the media, I want us to have a discussion where you can sit me down and tell me some things, advice, because we don't know it all. In fact, more often than not, the politicians are less informed than the newspaper editors, publishers, reporters, and journalists. So it's an opportunity to build a relationship with you, where at the end of today, of course, all of you will have my number. For those of you that have the pamphlet on your seats, at the back of it is my number. You have that number, please use it so that we can communicate directly. I need to hear from you, and I want to have honest, direct opinions. I won't be offended by whatever it is that you say, but I need to have that conversation with you so that we can truly understand what is needed to move the state and, of course, the country forward. That, of course, brings me into the issue of the governorship of River State. Now, many people make declarations. Some people do declarations in stadiums or stadia. Some people do declarations in their village. Some people do declarations in conference rooms like this one. And others do declarations in their houses. I am not going to be doing any declarations today. And to that extent, I hate to disappoint you. But I do want to say a few words. For me, it's governorship or nothing. Anybody who tells you that I'm interested in anything else, for instance, I want to be a deputy governor, or I want to be a senator, or I want to be whatever, president. Even if they give me the presidency, I don't want it. My only interest is the governorship of River State. And it is for that purpose I set up an exploratory committee to look into the viability of my candidacy. Now, they submitted a midterm report because I was aching for something to tell me how it progressed. and even though I'm not going to divulge the details of it, it makes pleasant reading. But very soon, the conclusion will be there, and once the conclusion is there, as I said, whatever they decide, I will abide by. I mean, we have very respectful people in that exploratory committee, including a former governor of River State. So we have men of timber and caliber, and we have youths in that committee, including existing students. So we have a widespread of people, and I have no doubt and every confidence that when they produce something, it will be something that will be a guide for anybody who truly wants to take the leadership of River State into his heart or her heart. So to that extent, I set up a committee and I'll be abiding by that committee. But I just want to say, between now and then, if you hear my name being mentioned in circles other than the governorship of River State, I want you to say that you've heard it from the horse's mouth. And that Toye Prinsfield is not interested in any other position apart from the governorship of River State. And it is that or nothing. Unlike most politicians, I have a life outside of politics. I don't even like politics, but I've come to the conclusion that if all of us shy away from politics, then we are doomed to be controlled by those that choose to stay within the politics. And so I am not going to sit down and wait for other people to dictate whether my children go to school, whether my friends have a good education, and whether my parents have to travel abroad for medical treatment. So for that reason, I'm getting involved, and that's why I'm involved in politics. But it's either I'm doing the governorship or I'm not doing anything. I just wanted to put that on record. Now, for River State, if we're looking at changing the status quo, we need to find people who can bring peace together. I am not coming out to be governor because I want to enrich myself or because I want to move a select group of people forward. No. I'm coming out because I'm interested in somebody who can bring peace to the state, somebody who can bring prosperity to the state, somebody who isn't a member of factions, somebody who believes that God is king and not man. I said it in an interview before now that whoever becomes the next governor of River State is going to be the hand of God. And I've said it that for me to be governor would take a miracle. For me to be governor would be a miracle. Because how can somebody who has never done politics until 2007 come and defeat all the heavyweights lined up who have been doing politics since the 90s to become a governor, who has never held a political office before, has never had the opportunity of political patronage, where even if they're not stealing the money of the people, they can use the money of the people to create what you might call alliances. I've not had that opportunity. I've not had the opportunity of enriching some of you with wealth from government to therefore buy your loyalty. And so for somebody like me to emerge to become the governor of this state would be a miracle. But that's probably why I will get involved, because River State needs a miracle. So for me, governorship of River State or nothing, exploratory committee report will come out very soon, and when it does, you will have the opportunity, just like me, to see what they have said. And of course, if it is positive and a declaration comes out of it, then the next conclusion, of course, is I'll be declaring to run for the office of governor. And in case anybody has any doubts, it will be under the platform of People's Democratic Party. I remember in 2007, when I contested for the seat of governor in Action Congress, everybody thought that I was a joker. They thought it would not happen. At the time, Sergeant Awuse was described as the bulldozer of reverse politics, and there was no way that I was going to defeat him. But in the end of the day, I did. And again, it was not my hand, it was the hand of God that did that. I didn't have the power to defeat him. But there was a lot of grace, a lot of luck, a lot of, I want to think, blessings that made that happen. So I'm looking forward to 2015. But in anticipation of 2015, I want to rebuild, reestablish, and reinvigorate my relationship with the media. So that's what this is about. Today is about reinvigorating my relationship with the media, building that personal relationship. I do not have the power to do this on my own. Part of the purpose of the exploratory committee is to find the kind of alliances that need to be made to make this thing happen. So, ladies and gentlemen, that's pretty much the long and short of what I have to say. But I have no doubt that if we can get another one of the mics working, we'll be able to take your questions. Please, there is no-go. Please, there is no-go area. So I will ask for Wade to moderate, and then we'll take the questions. Thank you very much.